Without further ado, I would like to, before I welcome Professor Ravindran to speak, I would like to thank Professor Rohini Godbole to give the second IMSA Distinguished Lecture. She needs no introduction. Thank you. And this is on a relevant topic in today's science, equity and inclusion in science, role that individuals, institutions, and society can play. Kindly, Professor Ravindran, over to you.
This is indeed a great pleasure to have Professor Rohini Godbole with us, at least online, to talk about one of our favorite topics. And this is, as you know, it's a part of our year-long program, celebration, to celebrate 75 years of independence. And it is indeed this moment to have Professor Rohini Godbole with us to talk about one of the interesting topics. So she doesn't require introduction to most of us. However, you know, there are young people in the audience who might know, might hear about her. So for their benefit, I'm going to talk about a few things about Professor Rohini Godbole. Professor Rohini Godbole is currently an honorary professor at the Institute of Science, Bangalore, and she is also well-known theoretical particle physicist, very well-known and very renowned physicist. She spent time at various universities in India, Europe, and the US, including CERN, Geneva. She has worked extensively over the past 4 decades on exploring the Standard Model of Particle Physics and the Physics Beyond Standard Model at the colliders, authoring more than 300 publications in journals, archived preprints, including graduate level textbook, a pioneering work on probing hadronic interactions of photons at colliders provided important insights for the designs of electron-positron colliders, and her suggestions to probe the Standard Model and Beyond Standard Model physics at colliders have been used in experiments at different colliders. She is an elected fellow of 3 Science Academies of India, as well as the Third World Academy of Science, TWAS, having been the council members of all the 3, as well as vice president of National Academy of Sciences, India. She has been the chief editor of Pramana, Journal of Physics, brought out by the Indian Academy of Sciences, and members of various editorial boards of national and international journals, and also number of international scientific advisory bodies, such as Energy Physics Advisory Panel in the US, the International Detector Advisory Group for the International Linear Collider, or the Advisory Board of Oxford Research Encyclopedia for Physics. She is a recipient of 4th highest civilian honor of the Government of India, the Padmashri, first woman to receive it for work in physics. Recently, the honor Audrey National Du Mérite was confirmed upon her by the degree of D. Literate Honoris Causa has been confirmed upon her by old universities like SNDP Women's University, Tilak Maharashtra, Vidyapeeth, and Doctor of Science Honoris Causa is to be confirmed by IIT Kanpur and so on. And an avid supporter of women in science, she has worked in a number of fora of more numerous and effective participation of women in science. This includes bringing out a book, Leelapati Starters, containing autobiographical sketches of Indian women scientists, as well as leading surveys to determine why women drop out of science after doing PhD. And these have provided some interesting insights on the issue of women in science. She also chaired the committee which drafted discussions on equity and inclusions in India's science, technology, and innovation policy of 2020. And of course, there are many, many. I can actually keep on talking. Okay, and I'm also proud to say that, you know, she was my teacher, you know, when I started my graduate program. And I'm really proud to have her here with, you know, in this one of the, you know, to eminent lectures to celebrate our 75 years of independence. I welcome Professor Rohini Godbole, requested to present her talk here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ravindran. as a teacher, one is doubly proud when one's people, young students and postdocs one has mentored, become directors of institutes. So thank you very much for asking me to give this lecture. It's a pleasure. And let me begin by sharing my slides. As I was saying in the beginning, it is a bit disheartening to have to keep on talking to people one does not see. But I think this is the times we are in. So we have to do the best of it. So I was really very pleased to, you know, let me begin by saying that Nanth and I, we are not, you know, strangers to each other. I have spoken many times with mad science faculty and students, but this time there is a little bit different something about this talk. And this is about, as was already announced, equity and inclusion in science, and more particularly what roles can we play as individual scientists, as institutions or society in this context. So what I will do, the plan of the lecture is kind of very simple. I will first discuss why diversity is important for equity and inclusion in science. Then I would basically focus on issues which are specific to gender diversity in the latter part of my talk. And I will argue that for all kinds of diversity, it is necessary to have both the policy changes as well as changes in the mindset. And then I would mention how considerations of equity and inclusion in the Science, Technology and Innovation Policy 2020 of India can actually help the sort of recommendations that exist in this policy. And having said that, I would spend my last 10 minutes maybe in trying to discuss how achieving the equity and inclusion that one dreams of needs contributions from individuals, institutions, as well as society at very many different levels, very many different contributions. So to begin with, you know, sort of there is a big plan that I gave you. Now I would try to kind of say first why I would use equity and inclusion and diversity more or less interchangeably. So let me just say that diversity is something which I think is induced by equity and inclusion considerations or efforts. And first, I would like to discuss why one should be talking about, you know, equity, inclusion, diversity, etc., in the context of science and technology. And I would try to argue that the diversity actually enriches the S&T ecosystem. And then I would try to give different types of diversities, and I would try to tell you which ones I would focus on. And then I would kind of ask a rhetorical question about, is the Indian S&T ecosystem diverse and inclusive? And I think the answer is indeed, from many, many different perspectives, it is not. So how do you work? How do we scientists, institutions work towards achieving a more equitable environment in science and technology? So having argued that this equitable environment is something that's going to benefit science and technology also, then I will work on, discuss about how to bring it about. And the major point would be, as you would see, and as I think all of us know, is that the two issues, it involves two issues. One is policies and one is changes in the mindset. And these are really intertwined. So of course, you know, to begin with, when we start talking about equity and inclusion in science, you know, people kind of first would say, oh, but we talk about equity and inclusion in the social context. Why are you talking about equity and inclusion in the science context? Now, of course, in the social aspect of science, there is this thing that one should talk about equity and inclusion to correct the historical injustices and to correct for the exclusion of the different groups, historical exclusion of the different groups from participating in processes of science, and we should correct for it. But I think it is important to realize that inclusion and equity is not only for this one, but it also aids in increasing the efficacy of scientific processes by making them multidimensional, increasing the dimensionality. And this dimensionality, increased dimensionality of the scientific ecosystem can only lead to further excellence in S&T. So what do I mean by diversity? By diversity in scientific processes, we mean participation of different diverse groups. It can be diversity of gender, it can be diversity of language, it can be diversity of social and economic class, it can be diversity of geographical region, physical abilities, knowledge systems. You know, and traditionally, as I said, historically, some of these groups get underrepresented. So achieving diversity has actually two aspects. One is inclusion for those groups which were excluded. And one such example I can give you is the traditional knowledge systems. And achieving equity for those underrepresented groups where some amount of inclusion exists. And there, I would like to take the example of gender. So this is the sort of point that we are going to try and discuss. I can completely well understand, people would say, why should we discuss diversity and S&T? Why should be lack of diversity be in S&T be an issue at all? I mean, after all, science deals with objective truths, and does it matter whether a small group looks at this, understanding this, unraveling the secrets of nature? Does it really make a difference? How can it really influence course of science? So another way of asking the same thing would be, can diversity really add excellence to science, add to the excellence of science? And there is actually, you know, I would like to give an answer by quoting from an open letter to the Supreme Court Justice of United States. And this was a letter from professional physicists, which was signed by about 2,000 physicists in the US in 2015 in answer to a question asked by the Chief Justice of US Supreme Court, Justice Roberts. And he asked a question, what unique perspective does a minority student bring to a physics class? So in some sense, he was asking similar question, what is the importance of diversity for science and technology? Of course, his discussions went a little bit further. There were questions about affirmative action and so on. We will not go into that. But the answer, and I'm quoting from this letter, is that science relies heavily on consensus about acceptable results as well as future research directions, making diversity among scientists a crucial aspect of objective bias-free science. This was the statement made by these physicists. The second part, somewhere was also in lower down in the letter, is that they bring the for example, in this particular case, it was minority students, that means racially Black students, African Americans. They bring their background, ways of thinking, methods of applying physics to real world problems, and the potential to educate others through their unique perspective. So my answer is somewhere similar to this, both of these together, saying that, you know, science is a creative activity. And any creative activity can only gain if we have more inclusive participation. Not having some groups participate in process of science, it's like not utilizing our intellectual potential to its, you know, capital to its full potential. It's like keeping some of our worth and our wealth hidden in the safe. So to begin with, I will begin the discussion by sort of saying some comments and myths and biases that one can ask in this kind of objective discussions is that, are all people equal when it comes to all sciences? And there were very famous statements. This was also somewhere, I don't remember exactly, at the maybe 2010, maybe a little bit later. Harvard President Larry Summers actually went on record saying that some of the research he had conducted led him to claim that women lack capability in mathematical and physical sciences. This was in the US context. True, in India, we don't have our Larry Summers. But at the same time, we are not inundated with women practicing science. Here, I'm talking of gender. Earlier, I talked about racial diversity. So as a result of this Justice Roberts question, in fact, in the US particularly, a lot of people started actually doing some social science research in answering this question, though it was rhetorical, as to what unique perspective does a minority student bring to a physics class. Now, whether it is minority of gender, minority of race, that's actually completely irrelevant. And there was this investigation on impact of gender diversity on actions. And this was a research that was published at the time that was only a little report in Fortune. And what they really found was that diverse groups are less conformist and more willing to go against the status quo if that leads to better outcomes. Whether a physics graduate goes on to work at a tech company, becomes a scientist, or ends up as a manager, it will be critical for her success as well as her employer's success if she's an original thinker. So this was one of the sort of results of the investigation where they had proved this, quote unquote, in some way by some research. Now, this is therefore my last slide about this, that the diversity among practitioners of science is really small across all the sciences. And I already asked this question, is that necessarily bad? And I have answered it, but I will answer it again specifically that yes, it is bad. I mean, this is not to say and not to decry the fantastic progress science has done. And for me, science somehow, for many of us, begins with Newton. So I would say since there's a time of Newton, the fantastic progress that has happened in natural sciences, of course, actually mainly white Caucasian males contributed to it. So obviously science functions wonderfully, but can science gain something? Could science have gained something if the system was more diverse? That is the question that we are asking. And that is the point that I tried to make, that not having diversity or the lack of diversity simply means that we are not optimally using humanity's intellectual capital. And diversity can only be good for science as it is for any other creative activity. So one of the examples that I would like to take is diversity of knowledge systems. Now, use of traditional knowledge systems, which use has sort of fallen off out in disrepute of late, it can actually lead to interesting innovations, which can make important contributions to the sustainable development goals. India is actually very low in achieving the sustainable development goals. So maybe we can look at traditional knowledge systems to help us achieve sustainable development goals. And that would be a gain of science. The second is diversity, racial diversity. In fact, in the USA of 1960, African-American women of the Deep South made all important contributions to the US space programs. Then in the case of gender diversity, I would like to give you a very small story of invention of calendar by Sonia Toksvig. She used to work at Cambridge. And she actually talks about a story that according to anthropologists, the first calendar was a bone with 28 incisions. And you know, it takes some time to realize that it must have been therefore invented by a woman. But till it was pointed out explicitly to her in an anthropology class, she said we attributed this invention to men or mankind. Now you may say it's just a manner of speaking, but in fact, this manner of speaking affects and has affected attitudes towards women in science for a long, long time. And I'm going to give you a few examples. So I repeat this again, that it is, you know, on this slide, what I really want to put to you is that how that lack of diversity could have led to loss of science and technology, and gain of diversity has actually led to gain of science and technology. So I'm going to tell you two examples of this. So as I said, it's silly to say that the lack of equity has impeded development of excellent science, which has really been mainly led by white Caucasian males in the last 300, 400 years. But the question that is more important and that one wants to ask and answer is that, are there any lack of opportunities for the bringing in diversity, opportunities for the diverse groups? Did it clearly cause science to lose something? So in other words, can achieving gender diversity or gender equity avoid such losses in the future journey of science of humankind. And here I want to give you an example of a very famous mathematician, Sophie Germain. And as I said, there are clear examples where the gender and the racial diversity was actually responsible for gain. And that is an example I will take from a wonderful book called Hidden Figures. So Sophie Germain, she lived 1776 to 1831. She did not live to be very old. She was self-taught and had to fight against the family and the society even to be able to study mathematics. It was not considered proper for a middle-class girl to study mathematics and science. And actually, family even took away her candles. But finally, they relented, you know, when they found that she was not to be stopped. And she started studying mathematics and science on her own in the house. She lacked formal training because, as you can see from the years, she was very young during the days of the French Revolution, and her father was some kind of a halfway general. And they ran away out of Paris, but they were living on their estate where she first got introduced to mathematics. Her father was a scholar. So she got introduced to mathematics at the age of 13 and was caught, you know, by the beauty and the romance of mathematics. And we call Polytechnic was founded soon after the revolution. But women were not allowed there. So she used the pen name of a friend to study and use the notes of a cousin who was studying in Ecole Polytechnique. And she would communicate with Lagrange and Gauss, et cetera. And people really appreciated. She did actually very important work in number theory. I don't have to tell it to people at Math Science. And she did actually very important work on theory of elasticity and Fermat's last theorem. And some works that she did, you know, that was very relevant to in case finally for the final solution of Fermat's last theorem. And she was actually the first woman to win a prize from the French Academy. But the interesting part of this prize is that her prize essay was sent back 4 times by the committee by saying that she is most likely correct, but the proof is not rigorous enough. And that really was due to this lack of formal training. Now, what I'm trying to say is that this woman, without any formal training, without the hardships in the early days, did end up making some very fundamental mathematics, and perhaps she would have contributed much more had her, you know, participation in mathematics been welcomed from the beginning onwards. Then there is a second story. It's about hidden figures behind the US space programs. There's a wonderful book called Hidden Figures by Margot Shatterley. And there are these three women, Dorothy Vaughan, Katherine Johnson, and Mary Jackson. Mary Jackson was the first African-American woman to become an engineer and study in a mixed engineering college, that is women and white and blacks. Dorothy Vaughan was the head of the computing center of the first avatar of NASA, which used to be called NACA. And Katherine Johnson was a mathematician. She was a mathematics teacher, in fact, and then was taken on by people who were hunting for help in the space program to do calculations. And she is the one who plotted the orbit of Apollo and also the orbit of the first astronaut whom US put in space, bring him back safely to Earth. So now imagine, I mean, again, look at the times they lived in and the times when they contributed to the space program. This was the time when the civil rights movement had actually started. And in fact, if you go and look at the newspaper reports of the times, and some of the newspaper reporters actually went on to say that USSR actually defeated US in the space race simply because they pressed all their intellectual power in service, whereas in the US, in 1960s, they were still talking about whether there should be desegregated schools. So anyway, these are these three African-American women who made fundamental contributions to the US space program. And today, US actually decries that there are not enough women in computer science and mathematics, etc. So it makes one wonder what exactly causes this lack of diversity. About the traditional knowledge systems and innovation, I will direct you to wonderful books by Professor Anil Gupta. But I'm just giving you an example from a talk which he gave on the, what is called Shodh Yatra. You can go to gyan.org and here there were these two examples they found, one in Andhra Pradesh and one in Meghalaya, where how they showed that tribal households were using waste heat to, in this case, to dry the husks, and in this case, the cooking heat to dry the damp wood in Meghalaya, where it rains enormously. Now, some of these traditional methods can actually be harnessed for some sustainable development methods. There is a very recent study in 2020, and how does gender diversity adds to the knowledge? And here, this is a paper which was published in Animal Behavior in 2020, and it says about the role of diversity in science, a case study of women advancing female birdsong research. As it happens, this has been a very, you know, sort of recent interest that people have begun to realize that even female birds sing a courtship song. And that was really not known beforehand. And this one says that this study actually shows that the fraction of scientists who were studying the emerging field of female bird songs were actually women. So this actually demonstrates the importance of diversity in addressing previously understudied areas of science, because it's only women who felt and, you know, interested in understanding the subject of female bird songs, felt motivated enough. And I don't have to tell you further that a further study of this kind of subject, how it can affect our ideas about, for example, how evolution even takes place. So therefore, this is kind of telling you how gender diversity can add to the, this is the point about dimensionality, increasing the dimensionality of the research. So, you know, what happens, you know, of course, science is objective. Science is universal. Newton's law would have been the same by any other name. So why is diversity science important? It is important because the issues in science we choose to investigate, processes that we put in place to do science, can also be influenced by the cultural or racial or the gender background. I mean, who we are affects the science we do. And for example, Shalini Arya of ICT and her work on increase the nutrition of chapatis is a very good example of this point that I'm trying to make. Let me give you a few more examples and how it affects what work we do. The first woman doctor from India to get her degree in the US, Anandi Bai Joshi, she did her thesis on gynecological problems of women because she herself lost a child at its birth when she was 14. And when she left the shores of India, she actually made this statement carefully and clearly that I want to go to the US and I want to study medicine because I want to help my sisters who have the same problems as I had and who feel not comfortable going to a male doctor. Another interesting news item, I mean, this is a sort of obvious example, but another interesting news item, which is sort of not so obvious, and this is a research by a lady, Professor Joy Bolwamini. I don't know whether she's professor or doctor. And she's a media, she used to work in the media lab at MIT. She's a computer scientist. And what she found out is that the facial recognition programs, which are basically developed using AI, are accurate only if you are a white American male. They were as likely as 35% wrong if you are an African American woman. And in these days of use of AI to help scientific processes, I cannot overemphasize the importance of diversity. Then the last one is a very simple news item in Deccan Herald that I had read a few months back, I think, where there was a case of an online application which required father's name. Now in Karnataka, even today, there exists a group of people, the Devdasis, where the children don't necessarily have a name of a father. Now, in the old days, when there was not an online form, people just used to keep that blank and the form was accepted. Now, in this particular case, because the form was online, finally, the girl put her uncle's name, her mama's name, and filled the form. But this again goes back to saying that in people who are in science administration need to be aware of this diversity in the social class that needs to be taken care of when you are doing things such as online application material. So what this tells you is that my first argument was diversity is intrinsically good for science, but there is also, it makes also very big pragmatic and economic sense. So the ecosystem is beneficiary and this I repeat again, that diversity increases the dimensionality and the complexity of the STI ecosystem. So why am I emphasizing this again and again? I'm emphasizing this to remember that achieving equity and inclusion is not to be done only with a sense of correcting a historical wrong. It should not be looked as charity to the underrepresented group so that their creative abilities get expressed. Surely that is one aim, but the second equally important aim is that there are many other aspects of diversity and its benefits to the scientific ecosystem. Why do I emphasize this? I emphasize this because unless we all remember this, then it can actually affect our own responses and actions to the issue. Unless we remember this, our actions and responses are governed by thinking that this is as a charity to the underrepresented group. Once we realize that it is not for that purpose, our responses are likely to be different. Now, of course, you know, it's very easy to see the lack of diversity and equity in science, but the question is, how do we cure this? And more importantly, I think also, how to judge what level of diversity and equity? Is there such a thing as a correct level? And here I would like all of us to remember that lack of numerical representation is a symptom, and achieving numerical targets does not mean that the problems are solved. Achieving numerical targets may be necessary, but it's not sufficient, and we have to get at the roots of the issue, and the solutions that we propose or implement have to address the reasons as well. So now this is kind of, I have tried to tell you what I think, why diversity and equity and inclusion are important for science, in what way they can help science as well. Now in the next part of the talk, I want to share with you a few thoughts about the ways and means to achieve this equity and inclusion. And I just hope that some of the thoughts will find resonance with at least some of what I say. Because the main point, even if whatever next I say gets lost in translation, let me emphasize what I want to say, the major point of my point of view, that the process, one of the important ways in which we can achieve equity and inclusion is that we can begin the process by becoming aware that there are not so, you know, there are many unobvious, subtle issues involved. Those are the ones that we need to handle well. So I'm going to take example of gender equity to make my point. To let me begin by this telling you what are the numbers about women's participation of science in India. So in women in science, the Indian story. So here what I am trying to show you is sort of a very pictorial depiction of numbers of women in science. And by and large, it can be supported by actual numbers from various reviews and surveys. And I will be happy to share with you some plots later. But in general, what in India happens is that in undergraduate, master and PhD, in STEM subjects, the fraction of women students among total is actually rather large. You know, in PhD, just today I checked in the physics department in IISc, we have about 37 women PhD students, among the total PhD students in IISc physics, including Center for High Energy Physics, we have about 37% students in physics, PhD students. Whereas when you come to postdoc and young faculty, even today, at all levels, it's not more than 15 to 20%, and when it comes to professor and senior faculty, it goes down even further. And when you start talking about senior leaders and high achievers, it goes down to a pity percent. And as I said, real data are available, but the Indian story really is this steep fall. I mean, the fall is always there all over the world, but in India, the fall is not in training, the fall is really after people have finished their training. How do we compare with the rest of the world in total numbers among practicing scientists? Women scientists here, this is a result from survey from by UNESCO. And you can see that India is governed by this color. So we are 0 to 30%, the fraction of women in science. As you can see, places like Russia are much bigger than us. They are, for example, you can see here, Russia is this color, which is 30 to 45%, and so on and so forth. China is like similar to us. And the actual number we have is about 15%. So, and the average national, the world average is 30%. So we are doing pretty badly. But from this particular plot that I show you, it is clear that in India, the problem is not so much, not just the human resource development for women, but more the human resource deployment. So we lose out the advantages that a diverse workforce can bring. We actually lose a big fraction of our trained human resource. And pragmatically, this is also a problem of low return on investments in the training that we have given. So, I mean, if we are saying that we are committed on the path of innovation-based progress, how can we afford this brain drain? So this loss of trained scientific human resource, particularly in the context of women, really needs to be stopped in the Indian context. So therefore now, when we start saying, okay, then how do we change the situation? How do we cure the lack of gender balance in science? When they want to do that, we immediately, someone of you might ask the question, why are you saying that you want to specifically discuss science separately? Mainstreaming gender in all walks of science is quite essential for harnessing the intellectual potential of the 50% of humanity. You know, so that is obvious, that's clear. What is so different about women in science compared to the women in all other walks of life? What are the additional challenges that women in science face? And there are obvious and visible causes, and there are two sets of them. And one, I will first talk about the one that is specific to science. And the one that is specific to science is what I like to call ticking clocks. The body clocks are ticking, but so are the clocks of the career. That is, in the case of a scientist, just getting a degree of a PhD doesn't make you a scientist. You have to invest a few years as a postdoctoral fellow to set your own path, to build your own niche. And this is also the time in terms of the age, the body is also not going to remain young forever. If you want to have a family, if you want to have children, it overlaps with the period in which you are also trying to build your career. And the beginnings in a scientific career, as a young research scientist, that period is essential. That period is also very tender, because you really need to work very hard. At the same time, the impacts you make in this period live for a long time with people. I can tell you that by self-experience. And so therefore, these two ticking clocks is something very unique to science. This does not happen in other sciences, other professions. You get a degree of a doctor, and within a year or two, you are capable, you can actually start practicing and build your practice. And it does not interfere with building a family as building a career in science does, because of this totally overlapping periods in time. The second one that is a problem is common to for all professional women, and that is family and career balance. And by and large, people think that let's take care of these two problems and the answers, then the rest will take care of itself. These are the obvious and the visible causes. The perception is that sort out these problems and everything will be well. So we have actually, I think here I have to pay, you know, positive, say something positive about Indian, at least the Indian governments, is that we have had policies to come back for a career after a break. We have had policies for flexi times. We have had special programs to encourage young girls to choose science and technology. We have training programs for women scientists to help them grow the, climb the rungs of career. But in reality, it is necessary, but it's not sufficient. And I would like to maybe come back to this comment in the end, that I think this needs to be realized by everybody, including women, that what is it that we need to have a successful science career? These two are essential. They are necessary to take, it's necessary to take care of these two problems. It's not enough. And why? Because there are invisible and unconscious biases. Biases about what a woman can do and cannot do. Biases about what a woman should do and what a woman should not do. And this impacts actually the mentoring we give to young women. It impacts the decisions that the young men and women take. It impacts the paths that young girls choose. So, and I think this can directly impact both the number of women that stay in science and technology and what they can achieve, both aspects. And in my opinion, all of these invisible and unconscious biases actually arise from the lack of importance that we attach to a woman's participation in science, both the society and the scientists. We are all very happy and supportive of women who are trying to be scientists. But after that, what kind of importance do we attach to their contributions to science is something that needs to be thought about more carefully. Not just that, so first, of course, you need to avoid biases in hiring and promotion. And that I will not even discuss too much. We can have that in questions and answers if necessary. After that, we need to avoid insensitivity to gender dependency of certain needs when you have hired somebody. Because I'm really talking only of post-PhD periods. So I think the bias that affects the hiring and evaluation for promotion is something that we need to sort of take special steps for this. But after hiring, we still need to see whether there are some special needs that we need to think. And for example, accommodation on campus. I can tell you this was my own experience, and even today I hear from young postdoctoral fellows that accommodation on campus is something that is preferable in India's reality for a woman even more than for a man. And the fact, for example, that childcare can be an issue for women students and postdoctoral fellows. These are the kinds of things that our institutions need to understand and be aware to these needs, which at least in my observation, it has taken quite some time, and still the institutions, Indian institutions, have a long way to go towards understanding these things. In fact, I just want to also tell you that these invisible biases very often create bias. And this is something we learned in the survey that we did, loss of trained scientific woman power, how much are we losing and why? And we learned actually a very interesting lesson that the invisible biases were a reason for the loss and not just the family responsibility. Again, I'm happy to share with you why I make this particular statement. And what is interesting is that these invisible biases are induced unknowingly, and they start very early. I want to take an example of a book, a very wonderful book by Sudarshan Khanna. It's called Joy of Making Indian Toys. And a friend of mine and his wife, they have had only one child, and they had no bias in the upbringing of the child. They had only one girl child. They gave her this book, and she made only few of the toys in the book. And they asked her, why did you not make the rest? And she said, but these were the only ones where girls were shown making those toys. And out of the total large number of toys, maybe only 20% pictures had a girl, and the remaining ones had boy. So she hadn't made them. So after this little girl made this comment, now the new book, modified cover and modified pictures in the book actually do show girls and boys in equal number. So this is a very simple example of a invisible. I can keep on giving examples, but that's really not the point. Each one has to introspect our own biases. Maybe I will just give one more story. It's a story of my own nephew. I remember this many decades ago. Now my nephew he's a genetist working in biology. And he, in fact, was young, 3-year-old. His cousin sister was maybe 5-year-old. And they were playing. I was working on the table. And I heard this conversation where the little they decided to play doctor. And the little girl said, okay, she told my nephew, you be the doctor, I'll be the nurse. And I still remember my nephew saying very nicely, oh, but it doesn't matter, you can be doctor too. My mother is also a doctor. Now, this is the invisible impact that I would like to tell you. And I would therefore say that it is very, very important for us to introspect our biases quite often. Even some of the cures that I told you to bring gender equity, these ones I told you here, okay? I will go back to those cures. The cures are these here, okay? Policies to come back to a career after break, policies for flexi times, and what have you. Now, all these things are also affected by a bias that a career break is inevitable and achieving family and career balance is a woman's responsibility. So in fact, in all these schemes, we need to have a gender neutrality. You know, it must be appreciated that the women scientists who care about their science as much as they care about their family, which is a norm for male scientists, it's important to realize that such women scientists might actually prefer support structures which allow them to get over the speed breaker by slowing down and not by coming to a stop and getting out of the fast lane. Now, it is important to appreciate such things when we make those policies. In fact, Royal Society also appreciates the cause of invisible and unconscious bias and actually displays this on their webpage very clearly. Now, there is a wonderful film called Picture a Scientist, which I would like you to actually see if any of you haven't seen it. And it brings this in the case of the invisible bias through interviews and conversations. The film is available on Netflix. And one of the examples in that is about activity, which is people are asked to carry up. The simple thing is there are two columns. In one, there are some activities, and in the other, there are names, which are male or female. And you are supposed to pair names with the activities. And even people who believed in complete equity ended up pairing things that male names with activities which are traditionally, unconsciously, they thought as male activities, whereas there is no such a thing as a particular scientific activity that is male or female. But actually, though this Picture a Scientist talks only about racial and gender inequity, the point that I'm making is not a propriety only of gender inequity or racial inequity. Think how often we do not pay attention to the suggestion of a person because he or she is not fluent in English. Think how often we do not pay enough attention because he or she is from a rural background. Or in science, how often we neglect a person's comments because he or she is trained in India as opposed to some citadel of science outside India. So we have to learn in our own lives to look at the content that we hear in an exchange. It should not be colored by our biases about the messenger. So the suggestion for this is that we have got to introspect and autocorrect for invisible bias in all ways, by all means. Is that going to be the only cure? Of course not. It is again necessary, but it is far from sufficient. And actual steps have to be taken on two different fronts. One is, of course, policies. We need to make policies. But then when we make the policies to achieve equity, we need to make sure that the policies themselves are not affected by the bias. And very often to make the policy implementation effective also requires changes in the social attitudes and conventions and being aware of one's own invisible bias, which is what I said here, introspect and autocorrect, is just one of them. And having raising this awareness is absolutely essential for successful implementation of the policies that would be put forward. Now, to me, it's a very heartening thing that the STEEP 2020 of India, which was released in January 2021, has taken a very big step by having separate discussions on E&I. And the discussion actually cuts across all issues. Previously, one used to have a separate discussion on gender equity, another for including those on the margins of society in the march of paths of science, the third one on geographical equity, and so on and so forth. But this time, the science and technology innovation policy decided that we should have a holistic approach. And then various recommendations in the different chapters are actually related to the recommendations that were made in this equity and inclusion chapter. And I actually like the statement that Ashutosh Sharma made in the introduction to STEEP 2020 policy, that key goals are to enhance ease of doing R&D, expanding funding opportunities, provided access to S&T information, technology and infrastructure. This is what STEEP 2020 wants to do, but to achieve this and become self-reliant, we have to be all inclusive, and that's reflected in the focus on equity in STEEP 2020. So this is again summarizing what I said in the first many slides, that inclusiveness, equity and inclusion are essential for a good progress in science itself. And this is this feature of STEEP 2020, which has a separate and comprehensive discussion of equity and inclusion. And I repeat this again, that the considerations of E&E should be an overarching feature of discussions. And more importantly, we need to focus on equity and not equality. I already mentioned this, that for me, any equity and inclusion discussion means there are two separate parts. One is to facilitate inclusions for the groups that are underrepresented and to facilitate equity for groups where inclusion exists to some extent. Particularly STEEP 2020 provides actually, I'm quoting from the executive summary, that this policy gives renewed impetus to the mainstreaming of equity and inclusion within the STI ecosystem. And the important part, which I am looking forward to, is development of India-centric equity and inclusion charter. This should be developed for tackling all forms of discrimination, inclusions, and inequalities in STI, leading to the development of institutional mechanisms. And that is the one that I may want to address to a very short extent in the coming slides. So the hope is that we will develop an inclusive culture such that there will be equal opportunities for women along with candidates from rural, remote areas, marginalized communities, differently abled individuals, you know, irrespective of their socioeconomic backgrounds. This again, everything I'm repeating from the executive summary. In particular for women, now these are the specific actions. And these are the specific actions that institutions can see how to begin implementing them in their own sphere before they become mandatory. And one of them is, of course, proportionate representation of women in selection and evaluation committees. Addressing of ageism-related issues and, that means that you do sometimes lose years and how to, you know, put different age limits. That is a kind of a question that one has to ask, and for the different milestones and consideration of experienced women scientists for leadership roles and regular gender and social audits in academic institutions. And this is what the charter is supposed to do. And at present, I really think that one can begin by creating awareness in scientific institutions, community, and society for the need of equity, and then only possible measures can be implemented. So therefore, I feel that time has come where all good institutions need to have a forum, at least for to begin with, women in science, which then can be extended to what we call equity and inclusion forum. specific suggestions, excuse me, for equity and inclusion. I include, and I will not again discuss this in great detail, but I already talked about equity and inclusion charter. There is now talk of mandating 30% women in decision-making positions across S&T system. Of course, the flexible timing and gender-neutral childcare benefits. And since there are some amount of flexibility implementing the current benefits, it's up to the institutional leadership to be able to take decisions such that these are implemented in the spirit and perhaps not to the letter. And most important that the institutions need to really be very proactive about is how to help couples so that nobody has to choose spouse's career over other their own career. So these are the different things which have been institutions can already start thinking about what measures they can take at their own level without before they are being mandated by the government. You know, I'd be happy with special schemes for women and girls. They are necessary, but they are not sufficient. And the other point is that I repeat again that any general measure that the government or the institutions want to harness, they should be, you know, we want to harness new measures such that the research can become more competitive, our S&T ecosystem can become more impressive. But whatever such measures we take, whatever such schemes we have, they should be designed so as to address possible disadvantages that women might face. Let me try to be specific. One example is the Inspire Faculty Fellowship of the Department of Science and Technology. It has an age limit of 32 years, which clearly puts women at a disadvantage. And therefore, this is the ageism issue that I was talking about. And we need to actually have in the policies a safeguard against discriminations due to age, which could be caused by a break. And in my mind, it need not be only for women. It can be actually gender neutral. It is more often than not would be used by women. But a gender neutral clause that a break that one should take into account only the academic age and not age. This can be actually a very useful thing which we have not yet done. And then, for example, promotion policies. My own institute, I would be happy to again discuss this in discussion. I'm proud to say that we have evolved a promotion policy which is perhaps an extremely adaptive and considerate promotion policy, and that those are the kinds of things which institutes can actually implement on their own before they become part of any government policies. At present in India, what we have is really special schemes to encourage women and girls in science, and some of them to keep them in science or to allow them to come back to science. That I keep on saying, they are necessary, but not sufficient. And more so, when all these policy recommendations, we should understand the spirit behind it rather than the letter. For example, right now it is being suggested that 30% of the decision-making positions should be women. Now, what is the underlying idea? The underlying idea is that women might be aware of the invisible bias, and therefore they will help the committee to avoid it in its consideration. So for a truly effective implementation of avoiding the invisible bias is to create the awareness among all the selection committee members of the invisible bias. It is not the job of the women who are the mandated members. So I am just thinking that once we have a E&I charter, which is being suggested, it can put in place measures to create such awareness. The institutions can already think of putting such measures in their own place that they do not in conflict. They are not in conflict with any other processes that the institute has to follow. So as I said, till that happens, till the center charter gets developed, what can the institutes and us scientists do? We can set up our own offices. We can set up our own groups, which will do the awareness raising. And these are not the women's study groups or women's study centers. This is us, practicing scientists. I find, for example, at Kurukshetra University, some colleagues have set up a Women in Science Forum, which actually finds a place on their homepage. I feel very happy about. There are efforts at IIT Delhi, University of Punjab, which are also extremely noteworthy. And I think those need to grow. These efforts, which are institute-based, need to grow. So we often seem to think that it is enough to make schemes and efforts to help and enable women students and faculty. But I think raising the awareness is as much needed, if not more, what institutes can do. The successful implementation of many of the policies, such as, for example, there is a scheme called WSA scheme. That is a scheme where women, at present it's women, who follow their husbands, can actually apply for a project to come back to science after having taken a break. And at that time, I have seen attitudes of many institutes, including my own, not very welcoming to these women who are trying to make an entry back into the science. So the successful implementation of any of the schemes, any of the policies, require institutional processes. They need to change. There need to be some changes in those processes sometimes, and there needs to be a change in the societal processes and societal mindness. My mindset. So commitment from many, many different structures is necessary. And all of this can come only by creating awareness. Awareness that this is beneficial, not just for the excluded groups, but also for science, and that it makes pragmatic and economic sense. This thinking has to become a part of our ecosystem. We have to introspect and autocorrect for our invisible biases in our professional and personal lives. We need to be inclusive, and it begins at home as to how we treat our spouses and our children. All of us, individuals, scientists, and science administrators, all of us need to be inclusive in everything we do. The situation when we will just speak of scientists or engineers and not their gender, surprisingly, goes through the path of being very, very aware of the same for quite a while. And here I quote from my own current science editorial, I think all of us, individuals, society, institutions, and the government need to work towards this. Thank you very much. And sorry for taking a few minutes extra.
Thank you, Professor Rogini. It's a wonderful talk and also eye-opening for people like me in particular. Of course, all the ideas are, one should implement it. And I think, it's quite encouraging also. We'll certainly, follow some of the suggestions that you have made with our colleagues.
Thank you. And that is the idea.
We will also, sort of have you, in a small discussion with our people so that we can successfully implement some of the ideas, actually. I think, it's really, really, encouraging talk, Thanks for your nice talk and also lots and lots of ideas, actually, which are very, very important for our society. Thank you.
It's open for questions. So whoever wants to ask a question, they may type in the chat window. Actually, ma'am, there was a question on the YouTube, if I may ask.
Okay.
Actually, you have addressed it later on. When we talk of diversity, why only we recognize diversity on the basis of gender, regional and geographical groups? What about the plight of LGBTQ plus people?
Okay. I normally, already the talk became long, so I removed this. But in fact, if maybe I can go back and say that in fact, in the equity and inclusion chapter discussion, let me share the screen once again to show one recommendation that was made in the policy, which actually explicitly mentions LGBTQ+. And I kind of right now talk about it as an advanced topic. You will see it here, retirement and spousal benefits for LGBTQ+ community. Can people see this now? I hope they can.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. So now the point is, yes, indeed, it is important. And as I said, I call it as an advanced topic for the simple reason that in India, we are not even right, and it's a good idea to think of everything all together. But sometimes I have also learned that, you know, when, you know, just to sort of give a very simple example, if this thing of rice, handful of rice, hot cooked rice is very hot, it's better to make it into smaller pieces. And that makes it sort of helps us finish it better. So similarly, I have the same feeling that this is important, but this is sort of an advanced topic that we have to take up. First, we have to understand in principle the importance of equity and inclusion. But I agree with this.
Ma'am, there is a question by Professor Murthy. Professor Murthy, would you like to ask directly or should I read it up?
I can read it myself. So I think I will read it out to everybody. What is the role of academies in addressing the question of diversity, not only in the election of fellows as a matter of recognition, but also as representative bodies of the scientific community? Yes, Murthy, I completely agree with you. And I think academies have to play a very, very important role as the bearers of scientific, you know, goodness of scientific processes that affect our entire scientific community. And it is, I would like to kind of, since you are a fellow of Indian Academies, you might have seen this document that the Women in Science panel of Indian Academy of Science has just now prepared, and which is actually available now on the web page of the Indian Academy of Science, which indicates the commitment of the fellowship to the cause of diversity. And to that, actually, there is additional document which is not been shared yet with the entire community, but has been shared with the fellowship, is about what actions academy should take in order to address precisely the question of representative bodies. And I do believe that time has come where we have to actively talk about these things and make sure that there is adequate representation in the different bodies of academy of women. I completely agree with you. And yes, that's what's happening.
Actually, one
Professor Ramachandran has asked, I think, this question, that do you want to comment on equal opportunity versus reservation or quota? Yes, I think it's a very important question. And in fact, RR, I would like to tell that in all my, you know, now I have been surveying Indian women, particularly Indian women, but actually I can say it's almost a global statement, that almost all the Indian women scientists who were surveyed and who were asked what are their recommendations, reservation or quota never came once. They were explicitly asked. And explicitly people said, we do not want reservation. We do not want quotas. And I think, in my opinion, a reservation or quota ideas, in fact, will backfire, will actually not work well. I think, to be honest, I honestly feel that being aware of the invisible biases we carry with us, if we are aware of them, and if we make all the decisions based on merit alone, I believe that equal opportunity kind of will take care of itself. I mean, I'm a firm believer in that. If for nothing else, when you see, you know, there is a very interesting example that Ashutosh Sharma once quoted for me, and which I found extremely interesting. He said that, yes, we don't see enough girls in IITs. We don't see, you know, number of girls in IITs are very small compared to girls. But whereas there is this progress scheme that DST has for young innovators called Manad, and that actually addresses young students from rural areas even. And they are by definition, two students from each school are selected, the best projects. And in that they find almost equal number of girls and boys. So somewhere along the line, the biases do make the change. So therefore the solution is not to introduce reservations or quotas, but the solution is really to create equal opportunities and create the awareness. At least that is my view, and I think it's supported by a fair number of people that I have talked to. Yes, Arar. Can't hear you, Arar. You are muted. You are muted, Arar. He has to be unmuted. Arijit, can we unmute Arar?
Ma'am, I'm trying.
Okay, so Arar, till you come back online, I will take up a statement by Jan.
Okay.
In
fact, the reason why I asked you is that I completely get upset when people ask for reservation, particularly political representation. There is a demand that there must be 33% reservation for women. I don't understand why. Why can't
absolutely
it be
50%? The only reservation
that is acceptable to me is 50% reservation. Now, this whole idea is that just like that, in any case where you really talk about thing, like for example, 30% of decision makers should be women. I don't believe that's right. It should be, we should aim at what equal amount of number of people both ways. Remember, in schools, the performance of girls are actually better than that of boys. And okay. Afterwards, somehow it declines.
Now, I will tell you why I supported 30%. 30% is a number I feel now. When we say percentages, be representative of the percentages of women in the scientific ecosystem. And right now, in the Indian scientific ecosystem, we have about 30% women. So I wouldn't want equal. That is why I made a very separate distinction between equity and equality. And that is why I made this big comment. That if nothing else, we talk about 30%, but the more important thing is to understand the underlying reason. And then if we can have all the members of the committee aware of the invisible biases, then to me, it doesn't matter if there is not a single woman. That is how I look at it. But I think the more important, because I will give an example what I mean by awareness. I have sat on selection committees in the Netherlands. And there, before the interviews began, or maybe it was projects, I don't remember, projects evaluation, we were given a sheet of paper. And, you know, we were actually asked to record our responses to separate comments. And from that, judge what could be the invisible, unconscious biases that we might be carrying with us. And I think, you know, for me, actually, it's very important that we do that. We don't even have a list of forbidden questions. At least the committee should be given that you should not ask, is your husband likely? What about your family? Are they going to follow you? As long as we don't ask that question of a man, we should never ask that question of a woman. In the US, it's illegal to ask this question. But in the Indian ecosystem, we don't even think that this is an embarrassing question. Or this is a bad question. I mean, I have seen young girls saying that, you know, and this I know for a fact, many of us postpone having children till we have settled, quote unquote, settled ourselves. Because you go to an interview, obviously pregnant, and you have trouble. So in the Indian context, and this sort of connects to Jam's question also, that I feel that to my mind, in the Indian context, I still believe that one of our biggest obstacles is the unconscious way in which we hamper the cause. I mean, I will not give personal examples, but I will tell you only one sentence to the, because I see only here most of the friends, so I can say this, is that somebody when I was young said, oh, I didn't realize you were so serious about science. And I don't understand why people have to realize this specially. If I am working, if I have had a PhD from the best of the institute in the world, if I have I've been a award winner and, you know, top place like IIT, why were they surprised that I'm serious about science? The only reason must be that I am a woman. And this is something, it's taken me these 40 years to be able to verbalize this. And it is this, I think, which all of us seniors, we need to think and change, you know, make our own, change our way of thinking. And we have to keep on talking about it. I mean, Jam, coming back to you, I mean, I have talked about things globally because these issues are indeed common to all cultures and almost the whole world. I mean, this I can say now with my interaction with people in the US, in the UK, in Europe. So I think unconscious things are common everywhere. And as RR says, yes, we have actually this good fortune that our universities, most of the prize winners are women. We have women who train very well, and then we are losing them. So in India, the biggest pitfall, the biggest care has to be taken for the early postdoctoral researchers. At least that's my own judgment. Since I see Meena, I will just use her name. But I mean, once we are in the system, I think we can, by that time, we have grown strong enough that we can handle ourselves. At least what I see in the US system or the European system, where people have to fight very hard against biases in the regular career development and jobs. We don't have to fight for equal pay for equal jobs to begin with. I mean, we have some positive points compared to the rest of the world. But I think the real, real drop off comes, and the real thing begins right after you finish your PhD. Two people go to an advisor, say husband and wife to be, and both of them got a postdoctoral position, one in maybe Europe and one in maybe China or Japan. And invariably the senior person will advise, why don't you just follow him and, you know, find something to do, might be a soft money position. This happens more often than me. And I think this is where, I mean, I'm talking in a very restricted sense right now, but I think even in that sense, if we make it work, then I think it's like a domino reaction, you know, increasing the number of women who are visible in science, in big institutions, in big awards and rewards are not something that the women themselves thrive on. But having a woman's name there, I mean, I will now say something, apologies, because I'm among friends, I can say this. But from the reactions that I have received to my getting the Padma Shri, mails that I got from young girls have made me realize that seeing a few women who are achievers, I see one more achiever on the screen with Murthy, my good friend Hema. So seeing more and more of these achievers, no matter at what level and where, makes a big, big difference in giving them the motivation. And in India, I think this is what we need. We need more visibility in the highest level for women. That is what I meant by saying that part of the thing is that we do not take a woman's science career seriously. That is to be done after she has done everything else properly. You know? She has fed her children, she has cooked her the meals, she has cleaned the house. And, you know, she likes to do science, so okay, let her do science. But the fact that that might take the whole priority at a certain point is not yet caught by the imagination of people. And this I can tell you again, anecdotal is true. I have seen very often young girls, young women in the middle-class society where I grew, whereas, you know, people would say, for you, it's okay, Rohini, you have now grown so much, you have to pay all your attention to science. But you know, she has just finished her PhD. Now it's time for her to concentrate on family. And I have heard this more often than not. And this attitude change, at least in the Indian context, to me is the most important one. But what we seem to think is that once we have schemes to attract young girls to science, once DST has seminars to somehow there is something lacking in women, that they don't know how to rise and take leadership positions. So we should train them for leadership positions. This may be true in another context, in other societies. In Indian context, I seriously do not think that's necessary. But what happens, again, the media, one should not underplay the media, effect of the media. I find young girls or women who are, you know, teachers in schools suddenly coming and saying to me, oh, but women cannot do mathematics, right? And I ask them, where did you learn this? Of course, they learned it in an editorial in New York Times. So what is the need in India, again, in the Indian context, is for people to talk about Indian issues. But even to articles in Hindu or, you know, good newspapers about gender, you will find that they're most times copied from somewhere else in the West, where the cultural aspects of the issues are different. And I think, again, coming back to your question, I think we need more indigenous discussion of the issues. People who will invest more into aware, making people aware of the issues and not what we read from UNESCO reports or UNO reports. Sorry about being blunt, but that's how it is. And that needs
need more Anandi Bens.
Sorry?
We need more Anandi Bens.
Yes, yes, definitely. Because I do think, I mean, when I heard, this is from a school principal who recently talked to me and said, isn't it true that women cannot do math, women are less in maths and science subjects? So I asked her, where did you get your data from? Because in India, really, we don't have any shortage of girls. Nobody is scared. I mean, as many men are scared of studying mathematics, as many women are scared. So, I mean, there is no special gender difference in that. Maths is still perceived as a difficult subject, but, you know, not just by women. But anyway, there is a question from Jaya, I think. Ah, Jaya, sorry, I didn't see the question till now. Jaya asked the question that she would like to know if women in science has a reach to women teachers at colleges who can be encouraged to do research and alleviate their problems. Indeed, Jaya, I would like to say that institutions, it is up to the institutions to set up such programs, at least in the their vicinity. For example, I would love to see a day when the IMSC, just like it has programs for enticing people, you know, popular outreach, women in science awareness can be one part of the same outreach. And one can have special programs for women, specially directed at women, to spend weekends or to spend holidays. And Math Science already has a wonderful program with its associates. I don't know if it still goes on, but I think it does. So one thing is, of course, is that in your associate programs, can you see that there is a equi representation? But on the other hand, you can actually, one can announce for one summer a program just for women in the local colleges and saying that it is only restricted to women, for example. And I think, I personally think that a lot of such small efforts can actually go a fair distance, because there is a, you know, catalyzing effect of all this that is very strong. So I would personally say, Jaya, that it's up to each of the big institutions like ours to set up such programs. That's how I would say it.
Any further questions? I don't see much in the chat window. Actually, ma'am, I wanted to ask a question, much more humble question.
Yes, so
many of the suggestions you gave are for leadership and policy decisions. But for a younger faculty who is training maybe women PhD students over 5 years, would you have some specific suggestions they should follow over the 5 years?
No, that's a very good question. I didn't talk about it. I agree. I think, but it comes under the general heading of trying to give a sense of worth to those young students, that it is important what you are doing, that this is not an end in itself, that career in science is as important as doing a PhD. I think even now, many of the young girls, I do believe that very positive about doing a PhD, working hard. But the fact that one should be doing a career in science, that is something is not so obvious to them. I mean, I can just give you an example that in Delhi IIT, I gave a similar talk. And one girl actually came to me, she's doing a PhD in one of the departments there. And she said, you know, I want to do a career in science, but my mother says that in a career in science is not going to bring you any money, and this is a completely it's nice you are a girl, so you can just do a PhD, and after that you should just get married. And this is a mother of 1921. So we have to sort, at least I feel that as a people, if we are aware of this thing, we need to give a sense to these young women that please take your career also seriously. I mean, I think in all this, the person involved is finally the one who will make the decisions. But how to prepare themselves for correct thinking? And correct thinking is not necessarily always to pursue a career in science. See, whether a man or a woman, after doing a PhD, you might actually find at the end of 5 years that his career in science is not for me. I mean, I think that can happen independent of whether you're a man or a woman. But the whole point is that there is a choice that you should think proactively and you should be the one making the decisions. This is something we can all try to imbibe, make them imbibe. And I can tell you this, that I have seen, I mean, again, in my 35 years, I have seen a PhD student from Punjab or from Rajasthan, you know, early days, saying that parents were not even allowing her to join PhD program, but then they allowed her because there was another girl in the same course. And this girl has grown from strength to strength. But the way she has grown from strength to strength is by observing and absorbing from the system. And we should make it possible by our discussions and by our behavior. And that is where Jaya, she's gone now, but holding discussion sessions, Jaya is there, yes. And holding those discussion sessions in, and particularly in the institutions in which you and me, we work, they're small. I mean, IISc is not small, but I would think of, when I talk of it, I would think of only of CHEP. And if I think of CHEP and you guys, we are a physics department, and CHEP and IMSC are similar sizes. But I think on a small scale, more meaningful discussions is actually, I think, the way to go forward. I hope, Arijit, I have not been completely gone off the track.
No, ma'am. Very relevant. Our outreach associate, Dr. Varuni, who is actually monitoring currently the YouTube stream, she asks me to mention to you that the IMSC Outreach does conduct a school program for girls only on the International Day for Girls and Women in Science. Certainly, we would request and ask you down the line to also get involved there. And we have noted your suggestions as I am part of the outreach committee for the outreach, IMSC Outreach. So we will keep that in mind. And
okay, Arijit, here I have one more message to be given back to Varuni, right?
Yes.
And that is the following, that we all do things on Women's Day. We do on things on Women's and Girls' Day in science. But the important thing is we need to do it continuously. We need to do it not on Women's Day. We need to do it not on Women's Day in science and Women's and Girls' Day in science. That is actually, and it's also equally important to train the young boys, because they are the ones who are going to be tomorrow the brothers or the husbands of the young girls who want to do science. And it is important to train them. So Indian Academy used to have a program which we used to call Women in Science, Career in Science. And I can give that as a suggestion to your outreach team and also to all your faculty. I mean, because this is not only to women faculty, because this is not a program by women for women. This is a program for women by all of us together. So we used to hold a program, and we have stopped it now, unfortunately, because different people have different preoccupations. We used to go to a school or a college for 2 days. And then we used to choose, very good women scientists, one biologist, one chemist, one computer scientist, one mathematician, one physicist. And they would talk about the science they do. And then we would have half a day of discussion on what are the possibilities for a woman for a career in science, what are the obstacles for a career in science, and how to avoid them or how to overcome them. And such a program, in my opinion, if each institution decides that they will hold such programs in the vicinity, you know, maybe 3 programs a year on occasions of centenary of Janaki Amar or what have you. Something like this can go a long way. And doing something centralized from DST, doing something centralized from Indian Academy of Sciences has its own limitations and has its own problems. But I think that is where I think institutions have to take up the battle. Then it can work better. This is my feeling, because the institutions need know the educational institutions near them better. And they can feed that need better. So this is my sort of one more suggestion to Varuni and her gang.
Varuni has heard your suggestions. She just wrote to me on WhatsApp. Actually, although we are over time, but there's one more question on YouTube, because it's somebody listening in live stream from Ravi Shankar. What happens if the girl is interested in research, but family is not supporting her? Although she will become financially independent, but still going against parents is never easy. Continued. Parents think PhD takes a lot of time, which will affect her future in many ways. How we can resolve such kind of a problem?
No, that's a very, very valid question. And I already referred to that when I said that I talked about a comment by a girl from Delhi. And it's an extremely valid comment. And again, unfortunately, for this particular thing, there is nothing other than education of parents. I mean, I can sort of quote my own case that when I was supposed to go abroad for studying for my PhD, I mean, this was ages ago, 1974. So many of the people in the audience, not here, which I see on YouTube, but on here on Zoom, but on the YouTube may not even be around at that time. And I know that, for example, my parents were told by well-wishers that if you send her abroad, she will stay there. She will take time to do her PhD. And when she comes back, her younger sister would have got married before her. And that would be a big, big problem. And not just them. When I was in the US, I can tell you this, that I had a friend, colleague from India, who was from a different part of India. And when he knew that my sister was getting married, he came to me and said, but aren't you feeling very unhappy that your sister is getting married before you? And this was a guy who was doing PhD in the US, okay? So if this feeling is there, and what I'm only trying to say is that from 74 to now, I have no reason to believe that this has changed too much. And you have to educate. But again, I am a sort of an optimist. You see, when Anand, like since RR mentioned Anandi Bai, that when Anandi Bai went to US, okay, which was now 1882, you know, something like that, which was 150 years almost now, no? And you know, that compared to that, we have come a very long way, much quite a bit fast. So I fully believe that this can change, and that is where I made this point also. This another point that I have noticed, and maybe this is something I can share with you, to the person who asked this question, is that if the girl becomes not just financially independent, but if she supports the family, that also makes a difference at times. Because we were running a program for rural girls from Karnataka. Karnataka state was running these programs. They were selecting girls from rural Karnataka who had achieved above 80% in the 10th and the 10th exam. Nothing very fancy. Karnataka. And these girls were then given special training, were asked to visit different institutions for 2 weeks each. And some of them came to IISc, we hosted them. And I remember one young girl, she couldn't even speak English very well, okay? Because she studied in Kannada medium. And she was telling me in fluent Kannada, I understood only part of it. But she told me, look, because in this scheme, Samsung gave each one of them a computer. So she said, before that, my parents were not willing to go to college. But once They gave me a computer. This was the first computer that my house had. Now they allowed me to go to 11th. And her brother was going to 11th at that time. They, the brothers and sisters in the same class. And she said, now I am, they are known as my parents rather than me being known as their daughter. And this is in not too far from Bangalore, but rural area of Karnataka. So giving the girls or the women some amount of financial support can go a long way. For people, you see, India is many countries in one. So one solution that, the kind of solutions that I suggested to the institutions and the actions, they are somewhat elitist solutions. We are already believing into women, people who have come up to a certain stage. But in India, for rural areas, we have to think of completely different solutions. And those solutions are like this program that Karnataka state government started, or even DST has started. So in India, we really need a multitude of programs. And I think the biggest problem is the scaling up, which is the issue. But going back to the question that was asked, I believe the answer is in the social change. And sometimes depending on the economical class of the family, if there is a financial incentive that can help the family, that can go a long way. At least that's my observation and my feeling.
I request now Professor Ravindran, our director, to give the closing remarks. Professor Ravindran, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Rogni, for wonderful talk and also the discussion that followed. We're really happy that we have heard so many suggestions, and I'm sure we'll take it up. And IMSC is going to be one of the examples that is going to follow your advice, that I can assure. Thank you again, and in fact, we will invite you again for discussion of this kind, so that we'll hear more from you, because this is 1 hour or 1.5 hours is not sufficient, certainly, because you have a lot of ideas, and I hope you will agree to that and help us. Thank you again.
Maybe if I can tell you one suggestion already. Yeah. Try to become a member of the Gati institution. Try to apply for a Gati institution, for example.
Okay.
There is a gender advancement transforming initiative.
Okay.
There will be a second call. There is one call that has gone out, and some pilot institutions have been chosen already.
Mm-hmm.
But the next call is coming up sometime soon.
Mm-hmm.
And please, this is a DST initiative.
Okay.
which is trying to develop this charter.
Okay.
Using the institution. So I forgot to mention it. And normally it's there in one of the slides, but I forgot.
It's called Gati, is it?
Gati, G-A-T-I, Gender Advancement Transforming Initiatives.
Okay.
This is a special program that the DST has started right now.
Okay, certainly.
Mm-hmm. And the second round will, I think applications for second round will be soon. But if institute has a lot of programs and a lot of ideas in place already, that will help a lot in, getting a good sort of grade, recognition and good ranking. This idea is to rank the institutions on efforts and a level of equity and inclusion.
We'll do that.
I broke you up in the middle.
We'll do that. Thanks a lot again. See you soon sometime.
Yeah, and all the best to everybody. And thanks for keeping with me for so long, for bearing with me.
Thank you for taking your time and talking about.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. See you sometime.
Bye-bye.